The content of this podcast is provided for general informational purposes only and is not intended as, nor should it be considered a substitute for professional medical advice.
Sweaty and pissed, menopause makes me sweaty and pissed.
This is Karen Nickel, nurse practitioner in for sweaty and pissed, menopause and more. Now for part two of our conversation with artist and media personality, Stephen Brown. Enjoy.
Let me ask you this though, Stephen. Do you feel like people are fascinated by you? And not only because you're just so fabulous and talented and so unusual what you've been able to build, but also they've got to think, what a sweet spirit, how fun. How, you know, people are fascinated by the South.
They are.
Well, you know, they talk about us and they make fun of us, but they're fascinated by us.
And for good reason.
They're fascinated by you.
There's a lot of crazy folk here, including myself. But, you know, for me, it's about keeping people guessing. Like when I have a party, and Karen Nickel has been to a lot of those parties. I used to have a giant orange and black ball every year. And when I would sit down to plan, and this was good unless you were involving a charity or because the party eventually got way out of hand and too many people and everything. But, you know, my planning session for something like that is, okay, what can I do that people are going to go home and talk about or go home and remember? You know, if I fill the yard with zebras, that's going to be something that they think about the rest of their lives. Now, zebras are hard to get. Sometimes you have to end up with zonkies, which is a zebra donkey, which is not quite as mean as the real zebras. But so for years, I would fill the yard with zebras and monkeys. There was a whole monkey period. And, you know, and for me, it's about keeping people wondering, dang, he is crazy. I don't know what's happening next because, you know, those are the things that set up memories that last a lifetime that, you know, do involve intrigue. You know, if people can guess what I'm going to do next, then, you know, I'm already slipping. So, you know, perhaps that some intrigue comes from just being a wild card.
Can I share a story just about explaining your vision and enthusiasm and wanting to make everybody's world a special place. I remember at the beginning of Glitterville, years and years ago, I was out at your house and you said, Karen, you got to come up to my studio because you had one of the bedrooms in your house was your studio. And you got to come up to my studio. I'm going to go to a trade show in Atlanta, and I'm going to show them my ornaments that I've designed. And we went up there, and there's this bookcase, and it was like three or five ornaments on there.
There were five
ornaments on there. And I was like, well, they were fabulous, first of all. And I said that, but I was like, Stephen, now you're going to have a big booth at a trade show and you have five ornaments.
But a lot of razzmatazz.
What are you going to do? And he said, oh, I'm going to make a magical world in that booth. And sure enough, he went down there and what studio was
it? Well, the funny thing about it was the booth was $5,000. And at the time, I was like, Lord, what if I never make $5,000? But I'd saved up that money and we got the booth. And the minute we got there, I only had one person's phone number. So I called them for a vacuum because we didn't bring a vacuum and we had glitter everywhere. And when that woman who worked at the Mart, who was very high up, she came to our booth, she said, honey, here's your vacuum cleaner, but I don't get people vacuum cleaners. That's not my job. And I said, well, why'd you come? And she said, because I knew you were excited. And she today is still a friend of mine. We became friends because of that. But she said to me, now, I have to tell you, Stephen, not everyone is successful at market. And you don't have a lot of product. You have
no kidding.
You have a handful of things. So, you know, I just don't want you to get overly excited. I said, you know what? It'll be fine. So when the doors opened at that 9 a.m. at that mart, the first person in the door was Country Living Magazine. And they said, oh my gosh, where have you been? We want to feature these. Can we take a sample? I'm like, oh, only five in the world. No, I'll mail them to you. You don't want to carry them around market. So they left. Immediately following them was Mary Engelbrecht's Home Companion magazine, which gave me the cover and 12 pages inside. And that was great. And then the next person was Department 56, which came with a licensing deal that lasted for the next 4 years. And they were the company that was famous for all the little village houses at Christmas. So it was a really upscale, popular company. So, you know, I stayed there 4 years. And then after that, decided, you know, I wanted to go in different directions. And, you know, but that was another thing of, you know, I had lots of warning of, you've only got five things. This is not going to work. But, you know, you don't listen, you just go on. And that doesn't mean that, you know, I never listen and things never go wrong, because they do. But we don't talk about those.
Well, the other thing I remember about that time, that period of time, is Stephen always had glitter on his face. Always. Every time I saw him, he had glitter on his face.
He was always, on purpose?
He was always working on a model or prototype and you know, doing it in his little studio in his Rockwood home, and he just always had glitter on his face. It was funny.
You might remember that same time was about the time I decided I wanted to do some vintage style ornaments that have a sparkly mica on them. And you know, mica is that fine glittery substance that's on old ornaments. But it was so expensive. It was like, I thought it was expensive at the time. It was like $12 for a little vial at the Michaels. And so I decided I would try to find it wholesale. So I called a mica production plant, and they use mica for lots of things. They put it in eyeshadow and lipstick and anything that needs a little glimmer, they put mica in. So I called, and they told me that a large amount was only $180. And I'm like, well, that makes more sense. It's going to be a lot of mica. Well, I paid the $180, and about 2 days later, I hear a beeping like a truck backing up, and I look out the upstairs studio window, and it was a dump truck with 2 tons of mica. And I just burst I'm like, oh, no, what have I done? So I call the place, and they're like, you bought a dump truck load of mica. So we packaged that. I put mica on everything, but soon it became a part of me. It was like I was covered in eyeshadow night and day because I had so much mica. Other crafters are barely sprinkling it on their ball, and I'm, you know, bathing in it. So you live and you learn.
That's awesome. That's fantastic. So is it my turn now to talk about pap smears?
Yes, you can if you want to, my darling.
Now, Leanne, I have to say, before she gets started, how lucky are you and I that we have this concierge doctor that we have?
Oh, I know, honey. I know. And you talking about, you know, here we're living in Tennessee, and she, the first day I met her, she said, well, I was an opera singer and I was in Manhattan and we had a baby and we didn't want to raise him around a bunch of old opera singers. So Andy, you know, applied at different, you know, for different positions at different colleges and, you know, became the voice professor at the University of Tennessee. And she said, and here he moved me and I'm in Knoxville and I'd been in Manhattan. And I thought, no, what am I going to do? But you think about what a blessing you've been, Karen, to people, and I'm not blowing smoke up your butt. She's got how many thousands of patients, and you can't get into her. It's like I've always said, it's like getting a ticket to the golden ticket to Willy Wonka. If you get in with her, and you won't believe the people that try to get to her through me. I've had to shut them down. But she saved my life. I don't think I was on death's door. But I was so sick and did not feel right. And I felt like I was asking, you know, I had a physician and I was asking, what in the world? Something's wrong. No, it's not. Yeah, but I think it is. Anyway, found her and I don't know what I'd do without her. I know that you feel the same way. And when we're out on the road and you're out traveling and something goes down,
Yeah.
You know, who are you going to call?
The other day she told us that she said, you know, during the coronavirus, I have to do video conferences for people's medical health. And I said, oh, my gosh, that must be terrible. She said, terrible. You've been doing it for years. And I said, well, that's true. And the most recent versions of those was we were in the middle of an Oprah shoot. And I started feeling badly. And I told Brian, I said, oh, I feel bad, but let me go to the bathroom and I'll come back and I'm probably going to be okay and we can carry on. And, you know, Brian, he doesn't care about my health. He's just afraid he's going to have to go do something, finish something with Oprah that I've started that, you know, maybe he didn't have the keys to. So I come back and I'm feeling bad. And I said, you know what, let's just go to the hotel. It's next door and I'll be okay. And let me take all these packages because I'm probably going to work on them tonight in the room. So I have him loaded up with a pile of packages and I have a load of packages and off we go to the hotel. Well, by the time we've gotten to the hotel, I can barely walk. I think I'm going to die. I tell him I'm definitely going to die, but let me call Karen and make sure. So, and I refuse to go to the hospital because, you know, in Manhattan, it's just easier to die than probably go to the hospital. Or it was for me in my condition. And it turned out that I had a kidney stone. And it was the most painful thing that you could, I can't even, childbirth, they say, is similar. So I got in the shower and I'm calling Karen and Brian said, did you talk to Karen? I said, no, she has not answered me in the 5 minutes that has passed. So he then texts her and then we get a call back from her saying, oh, I'm sorry to inconvenience you, but I'm on a remote island at a wedding and it's 11 o'clock on a Saturday night. So I'm sorry I wasn't there for you, but what you've got is a kidney stone and this is what you need. And she called it into an all-night pharmacy in the city and Brian went and got it and I suffered. And by morning, I was back on that Oprah set, tying bows and putting on dresses and, you know, all that stuff. So that was the most recent real tragedy of, oh my gosh, if I had not gotten a hold of her. But I'll never forget. I'll never forget her response, though. I'm sorry for the inconvenience. I'm on a remote island at a wedding on a Saturday night at 11 o'clock. So sometimes that medicine, all of that medical advice comes with a little bit of sass, too.
Yeah, it does. As a comedian, and I've got a sold out show, and then you know I'm feel like I'm gonna have explosive diarrhea, or I can't talk, like I've, you know, my throat's sore and I've got a fever, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, and this is pre COVID, but you've got an audience, and I'm thinking, oh my gosh, what am I gonna do? I've had to call her and go, what the? And she's had to send me, you know, anti nausea medicine, anti diarrhea medicine, you know, to tell me what to do so that I can do a show.
Yeah. Now I know I know you're just like me because, you know, my whole place is built on the idea of cupcakes and fantasy and sweets and cakes. And I used to eat a lot of those. I don't eat as many of them now. But, you know, when we both first started going to Karen, you would tell her all your wounds and all your problems. And she'd say, and maybe not in these words, but she'd say, honey, that's just your gluten a hootin'. You need to stop eating flour, stop eating bread. And I think she finally determined I was a lost cause on gluten. And I know you've gone through the same thing.
Yes, honey. I walk in with a book, plantar fasciitis. She goes, you know what you need to do, Leanne? And I get off of gluten, it goes away.
Yeah.
And I feel like now that God has put this on my heart to get out and tell young people not to have sex with strange people and get HPV virus, and to tell people don't eat gluten if you've got plantar fasciitis. If you're in a booth, quit the flour and it'll go away. I feel like, haven't I? Because she's been my provider since I had a show on Sirius XM. And I don't know what my kids were getting the HPV shots during that. And I just feel like they were at UT. And when my son, who is like a Billy Graham, he is. I mean, he's not perfect, but he's an old soul, Stephen. He woodworks, you know what I'm saying? So he goes in, is going to Berry College. And she looks at him and she goes, Charlie, 8 out of 10 girls in Berry College are going to have vaginal warts. He was like, what? He looked at me. Oh, my gosh. So anyway, she has been weaved in and out of our lives now. And we tell her and she tells us and we, you know.
Now, I have to ask, has she ever, I'm sure you've been on it, has she ever put you on the yeast-free, sugar-free diet?
No, I have not been on the yeast.
Oh, my goodness, Karen Nicola, I thought that was your...
Well, honey,
staple.
Wait a minute. You were living on cupcakes at the time, so...
Well, she has a diet plan, and you heard it here first, people. She has a diet plan that is a... When I first started the medical part with her, long after I started putting wigs on her at the opera, she had a diet called the yeast-free, sugar-free diet. And you go on this diet, but you also take a supplement called nystatin, which kills the yeast in your body. So you're eating no sugar, no yeast, and you're taking a nystatin tablet, which causes die-off in your body. And I started that, and one day I called her, and I'm like, you know what? I don't feel like I can stand up. I feel like this is the end. She said, that's just the gluten. That's just the gluten, and yeah, it's an example. Yes. But the thing about that diet is it is insufferable for a month. You feel terrible. But at the end of it, you've got great skin. You've got great hair. Everything looks good. You feel better. And you lose. Men lose 25 pounds. I think women, my friends have gone on it, and women lose about 20 pounds in a month. So anytime I have some TV thing or something I have to look better for, I immediately call her and say, oh, I need some nystatin. I have to go on the diet. So it's painful.
Well, okay, Karen, you have not given me the nystatin. Now, I have done Whole30, and we were doing a podcast, and I walked in and I said, I'm so sick, I'm going to die. And she goes, you've got yeast die-off. I remember that. I remember you saying you've got yeast die-off, Lynn. And I was like, what? I felt so, but you're right. It makes you look good. And I did that kind of that thing before I had Dr. Phil. And I looked like I was 30 years old, like a young, and I was 40 probably, 40 something. And I looked like a different person. And I was eating whole foods, no gluten, no sugar.
And it's scary when she...
Can you tell I've been eating it? I look like Carol Baskin. I say it every time we do something now. I think I look just like Carol Baskin with the wreath of flowers on.
Now, it's scary when she first puts you on it because she says, now, Stephen, there's going to be yeast come out in places you might not expect, like between your toes. And I'm like, I don't think I've got that much yeast in me. And to date, I have not had that much yeast in me, but...
What do you mean? Comes out onto your, like a yellowish, yeasty looking something comes out of your toes?
Sometimes when you do yeast free, you can get breakouts of yeast symptoms like yeast vaginitis or a fungal infection on the skin or, you know, so I just warn people that might happen. And I warn them about yeast die-off, that they're going to feel terrible like they have the flu for a couple days.
You do. Uh-huh. It gives you the earache.
You don't need to go anywhere or do anything during a yeast die-off.
No.
Okay, Stephen, do you, oh my gosh, what was I going to just say to you? And I'm 54 and in brain fog and it just leaves me. What was that? You must have been doing, I was going to say, you look good. You must have been during this COVID.
Oh, no. I've done nothing but eat, and you know, it's so difficult to get to food. And you know, we live a lifestyle that, you know, we're usually traveling all over the world, and I'm never even here in this month, or so our next plan is always to eat every meal out somewhere. But with everything closed, you know, you have to call it in. You have to, you know, so it's difficult. But my go-to has been pizza, unfortunately. So
I love it, honey. That's my red flag Weight Watchers food. Lord, I love it.
So a pizza a day has not helped my situation, but you can offset that with good lying.
Well, that's brave of you saying it in front of her.
Oh, she knows. There's no lying. It's like she'd just be like, "It's your gluten a hootin." It's like, "Yep, I know."
Well, Stephen and his alternate reality in terms of medical care. When I have new nurses and he's coming in for an appointment, I always say, "Now listen, Stephen Brown is going to tell you stuff that is just not true," and he'll come in and they'll take him to the scale. And he says, "Oh, Karen Nichols says I don't have to weigh when I come in." And they go, "Oh, okay." I'm like, "No, do not listen to him.
You're new here. You don't know the rules, but Karen has a thing where she doesn't like for me to be weighed."
Yeah. That kind of stuff.
And only one, I think, has ended in tears. But I've seen a lot of nurses there come and go.
Yeah. Well, and I was going to say, do you come in there with Dolly in a bag? Is Dolly the chicken with you, or does she stay at home when you have doctor's visits?
Dolly's been to lots of doctor's appointments. I know it. Probably shouldn't talk about that FDA. Dolly's never been there. Dolly is
HIPAA.
Reigning in her bed at home. Yes.
Oh, but I love Karen's office, and I've told her it needs to be a sitcom with Gary, all of them.
It should be.
It is a sitcom, honey. I just don't have the nerves to sit down and write it. I've got so much that needs to be done. I'm producing an album right now, and I'm supposed to be writing, and you know what I'm doing? I'm baking bundt cakes. I've been on a bundt cake thing, and I've been making Jell-O salads, and I was raised in the country where everybody had a Jell-O salad, and I thought, oh, that's just for little bitty Methodist people. Turns out the Episcopals, everybody makes Jell-O salads. Honey, they're making them in South Dakota all over, and I've had a ball. And I thought, oh, you know, Stephen, you and I need to come out with a Jell-O mold that we could sell that would be very glittery and, you know, but something to get people through the COVID. You remember those Jell-O molds that were so beautiful and ornate, and you know that? I mean, they've got stunning ones. We should do that.
Oh, I've got a few of them because the Czech Republic, oddly enough, we were there, and because we were producing glass ornaments there, and we went into a place and they had tons of bundt cake molds and Jell-O molds, and you know, so I stocked up there on shapes that you don't normally get. But I saw on Instagram you were really promoting the Jell-O salad.
Well, yes, I've single-handedly started a revival.
Now, and, when I was at UT, I always knew people who I never really, students were not really my audience or the people I spent the most time with. It was always others outside who were already established, and they would invite me to their house for dinner or some function. And there I was at UT, and I was living in the dorm and I didn't have anything to do anything with. So for a short time, I said I was going to write a recipe book on things you could make in the car, but arrive with looking splashing. And one of them was, we called it pink fluff. And it was fruit cocktail, Cool Whip, cottage cheese. And you whipped all that together and everybody loved it.
Oh, honey, yes, they did. That's a fluff. I've been making fluffs. But you use a fruit cocktail?
Yeah, well, you have to drain it. And then you put that in and mix it all up. It doesn't hold in a mold, though. You have to put it in something that you can dip
in
it
a little
out
bowl.
Of. Yeah. But it's pretty yummy.
I've been making cherry fluffs with cherry pie filling and sweet condensed milk.
Oh.
Cool Whip and pineapple. You know, you can put crushed pineapple in anything, Stephen, and just dazzle.
Yes. No, that's the... But you know what? The only thing I found was for a while when the books started first coming out, we were working with a very dignified food writer and producer in New York. And I submitted a recipe once that had Cool Whip in it. And it was almost... That will end a food career. I'm just going to tell you. When they hear Cool Whip, it's over. And so Brian looked at me and said,
I bet.
He said, now what? I'm like, well, we're going to change that to cream. We're going to whip it up. And then I made that. And you know what? Cream just cannot do what its cousin Cool Whip can. It just can't. It can't hold up. It doesn't have the strength.
I know. Well, I think the COVID has changed all that. I think that people are okay now with Cool Whip, honey. We're all trying to get through.
It's just survival at this point.
Well, speaking of that, everything you guys have talked about, I'm sure is going to help our listeners get through this. It's been a fun, really fun visit. And
look at Karen Nickel cutting off our conversation.
Stephen, listen to me. Are you open? Is it against the law if I walked in the door? Can I come to Glitterville, or will the law get me? What is going on?
No, I have monitored where you've been, so I'm gonna deem you safe to come to Glitterville.
Okay,
with a mask. Really?
Now okay, I expect to see a bundt cake or a Jell-O salad in one hand.
Honey, I would love to take a craft class. I would be on fire. And now that I'm not touring, I hope. Some dates they're talking might go in July, but who knows?
You know, Broadway is closed until September now. They announced that yesterday. At least September. Hurts me.
Oh, honey.
Look, Karen's given up. She thinks she can't get a word in up there. I can tell. Her face is just, I've lost it. I've given up.
We're talkers. Stephen and I are talkers.
I know. No, it's fantastic. So, but I do want Stephen to... Can you tell everybody, our listeners, where they can find your products and how they can follow you and all that?
Well, the products are everywhere around the world in stores, both mom and pops, probably in your town or city, and at big stores like Anthropology, so places like that. They can also go to our website, which is glitterville.com. Or to keep up to date on everything and all the wackiness, the best place is Instagram, which is just under Glitterville. So you can follow me there.
Yay.
Y'all are all going to be fascinated. You're going to be fascinated. Yeah. And he is our Tennessee boy, honey. And we're proud of him. Oh, my gosh. Fabulous. All over the world. Anthropology. Do you know I've got two daughters and a daughter-in-law? I stay at an Anthropology.
Exactly.
You know? Everything you do is unbelievable, my darling. Thank you for coming on, you angel.
Well, thank you all for having me. And you should both come to a sidewalk lunch with us. That's a lunch where we told Karen Nickel that she could come, but we have to sit 6 feet apart on the sidewalk in front of the studio, which we did, which was very fun. So we could add a third seat there.
Okay, my darling. I would love that.
Thank
you.
And I also, before we go, want to just give a shout out to Brian Crabtree, who is your partner in crime in the Glitterville business. And I know works really, really hard, for the company.
He does.
And, if he's in the background somewhere, hey, Brian.
He's over there at his computer.
Working away.
Working away. So he's probably saying, somebody has to be working.
Uh-huh. That's what my husband's saying.
You know, Leanne, you're going to work on that backdrop.
Yes.
And Karen, you're going to work harder on your Instagram so people can follow you on Instagram and see all that fabulousness that you do on a daily basis.
Well, yeah, I'd have to find some content first, see.
You're right, Leanne. She's too busy. She can't do pap smears.
But we could, on Sweaty and Pissed, we have an Instagram that we ignore. But we could put Stephen's picture up, and that will give us some credibility.
Yeah.
So we'll do that.
Yeah, we'll do it. We'll do it. That's great. It's been
okay,
so
honey,
much fun
thank
to have you.
So much. I've had a ball.
Tons of fun.
Know.
Love you, Stephen.
Yay. Love you too. You all be good.
All right.
And do you not have a tagline you sign off with? I mean, mine is always just remember, make it and make every day a holiday. You all have to sign off with something.
Well, what, can we
is
use
just
that?
Goodbye? Sure. Make it and make Maybe every day sweaty and pissed.
Yeah, let's not be sweaty and pissed. I don't know. We've got to come up with something. Thank you. You've given us goals.
Yes.
We've got homework, Karen, and we've got goals. We got it. All right. We'll be working on it, you angel. That's
Yay.
How you made what you have made. You're a goal-oriented person.
I'll be watching for the tagline.
All right, my darling.
Thank
All right.
you. Bye for
Thanks,
now.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.